This is a dream come true. I'm completely overwhelmed and can't quite believe this is happening. But I'm really excited to see the film on the big screen tonight. The book is a northern urban fairy tale that talks about Arthur Braxton, who's about to end his life, and he hears a siren singing from an abandoned bathhouse, and his life changes forever. Well, it's actually a retelling of three Greek myths, which is great, but it's good. It's northern, it's really sweary, and, you know, just a new, fresh voice, a coming-of-age story. I think it's about storytelling, the art of storytelling, and trying to make Greek mythology accessible to a new generation. You don't need to know the myths to enjoy the book, but hopefully, if you read really closely, you'll see the myths, and also maybe a guest appearance from the Muppets, too. Luke first approached me when he was 21, and my publisher at the time thought it was madness that I'd even consider giving my film option to a 21-year-old. But he was so enthusiastic about the book, and he's brought something really fresh and original to it, something I don't think someone from my generation would have been able to do. I've seen the finished film, but not quite, not the version I'm seeing tonight. I've never seen it on a big screen, so this is a completely new experience for me with the music and everything in the background, so I'm really excited to see it. Well, Johnny was always in mind. I think that the casting of Arthur Braxton, James Tarpey, is absolutely perfect, exactly what I imagined. And the character of Laurel as well, Sophie Wright, I think that she's superb. Everything I want.
And obviously we're here at Raindance Film Festival. What does it mean for you to now be a part of that festival, this celebration of independent storytelling?
You can just feel the enthusiasm walking around. I actually can't believe I'm here. Absolutely thrilled and honoured to be here tonight.
What does it mean for you yourself to be a storyteller?
For me, story is about giving voice to people who are marginalised or aren't being heard. So for me, it's all about telling stories that need to be told.
My name's James Tarpey. I play Arthur Braxton in The Drowning of Arthur Braxton.
Amazing to have you here with us at Raindance. Can you start by telling us a little bit about who your character is and the very unique situation he finds himself in this film?
For sure, yeah. So Arthur is he's having a tough time at school. He's kind of getting bullied by a few people, and he's not got the greatest home life, but it's kind of tumultuous. And so he kind of seeks out this new friend he makes in an abandoned bathhouse. It all kind of evolves from there, to be honest with you. Yeah, it's like his olive branch of something in a kind of dark world, I suppose. Yeah.
Obviously, you're working with a very exciting young director with Luke. Can you talk a little bit about that experience and what he's like as a storyteller?
Yeah, it's really fun, man, to work with someone who is very keen to kind of prove themselves, and they've got a lot of energy, and they want to try things. It's really nice. It's really nice. He's not like a jaded by anything. Yeah, it's like excitement. Yeah.
Of course, your father figure is played by the immeasurably talented Johnny Vegas. Can you talk a little bit about what that relationship was like on set and off?
No, he's a great guy, man. He's a great bloke. He's a good fun, you know, he's a laugh. And he's just really talented as well. Like, when he turns it on, he's got the chops. So yeah, man, it's very, very fun working with that guy. Yeah. Johnny's a legend. Yeah.
Can you talk a little bit about some of the themes that this story explores? Because it's a very interesting marriage of kind of Greek mythology, but very real kind of northern kind of grittiness.
Yeah, for sure. It's a great meeting, I think, of those two kind of worlds. It feels quite grounded in reality, whilst at the same time having this element of fantasy that hopefully makes it a little bit, gives it a little bit of spice, makes it a little bit interesting. But, you know, I've not actually seen it yet, so I have no idea, what it's all going to be like, to be honest with you. I just remember shooting it, 6 years ago. So it'll be good fun to see it. Yeah, I'm excited.
So she is this magical water nymph who's never met anybody before, apart from the two people that she lives with in this, like, mystical bathhouse. And I think it was something to do with, you know, her naive innocence with the whole world and having to learn it that just really appealed to me. And she is just, you know, she's a child at heart, but also a woman, which is quite complex and beautiful. And it's a love story, which I adore.
Can you talk about James, who plays our titular Arthur Braxton, and working with him?
Yes. So when we were doing the callbacks, we were just doing Arthur and Delfina throughout the day, just changing couples to see who had chemistry. And so I'd been doing this scene all day, and as soon as he walked in and started the scene, I forgot all of my lines, because he is just so incredible. And he's such a joker, and yet as soon as action is called, he just zips on this, like, I am Arthur Braxton, and you go speechless. He's phenomenal. Yeah.
The man calling action is standing beside you, Luke. Can you talk a little bit about what he's like to work with as a director? And obviously, as a young director, what gave you the confidence that he was the right man behind the camera?
Yeah, I mean, obviously, Luke started in YouTube, and I never really watched YouTube growing up. But when I'd gone to the auditions, I obviously met him, and the way that he directed and spoke and the passion that he put behind it, I was like, wow, this guy really knows what he's talking about. So I went away and watched some of his YouTube videos, and I was like, he seems completely insane, but also like a lot of fun. And yeah, I think his YouTube persona and his directing is very, very different. And he knows the script like the back of his hand. Any questions that you have, he's incredible. Yeah, fantastic to work with.
Your character is quite tied to water in this film. Can you talk about the production challenges of that aspect of the character?
Yeah, good question. Yeah, so she never comes out of the water. And so I was in a swimming pool for about 2 months. And thankfully, the swimming lessons as a child really paid off. But yeah, I think it was more trying to, you know, stay warm, because this place had lots of broken windows, and it was in the middle of February, and it was really quite cold. And also hit marks in the water when you're underwater and have to come up at a certain point and you can't see, is hard. And make it look as though this is your completely natural habitat and this is all you've ever done for your whole life. It was tricky, but it was good. And I love swimming, so it was fine.
What does it mean for you and the rest of the cast to be bringing the film here to Raindance Film Festival?
It's just the best experience ever. I mean, we shot it 5.5 years ago. So it's been a lot of blood, sweat and tears on Luke's behalf, and obviously a lot of waiting on our behalf. And it's so incredible to come to Raindance, having won Best UK Feature as well. So all the time has been worth it. Why storytelling matters in our lives. I mean, I think that I've always been somebody who disappears into their imagination. And I think storytelling allows us to kind of go into different realities when maybe our own isn't everything that we want it to be. Obviously, over a pandemic, reading and watching, you know, TV shows was a massive part of everybody's life. And I think it brings a lot of joy. It brings a lot of education and things that you'd maybe never have thought of before. And it's just, I mean, it's escapism, isn't it? Yeah.
Hi, my name's Sophie Wright. I play Laurel in The Drowning of Arthur Braxton, and I'm one of Isaac's two producers.
What does it mean for you and the rest of the team behind the film, not only to be part of the festival, but to already be an award-winning Best British Film here at the festival?
Oh, insane. I couldn't believe it. I watched the Instagram Live from home yesterday, and I screamed and dropped my phone. It was such an amazing moment when we won that. But yeah, because this film's come from very, very humble beginnings, literally a phone conversation between me and Caroline, and then it's turned into an award-winning film, and we scraped blood, sweat, and tears to make this film happen. Like, we filmed in my garden, some of it was down the lane, everyone was living at my house at one point, so we really did scrape our way through, and now we have an actual feature film.
What was it about Caroline's original story that made you and Luke so determined to bring it to vivid life on screen?
Well, I think it was that, so Caroline got in touch with me after seeing Mad Fat Diary, and so she was like, I want you to read this story because I really want you to play Laurel. So I read the book, and as soon as I started to read the character, I was like, yes, this is me. This is exactly, I wanted to play that character so badly. So when I told Luke about it and was like, I think we really, really need to make this film, then he read it and he had the exact same feeling. It's such an important story, I feel, that it just needed to be out there. It needed to be visually told.
In terms of that character, for people who obviously haven't read the book, can you tell us just a little bit more about Laurel, where she fits into the plot?
So Laurel is, she isn't one of the water nymphs, but she's one of the, I don't want to give too much away, she's one of the magical characters in the bathhouse. She's got a very, very troubled past, but she is very caring towards Delfina and the other characters. So it was very much, if you read the book, you'll understand there's a lot going on to Laurel. So that's why I was so excited to put my all into it.
You talk a little bit about the amazing cast you've been working with, particularly working with Rebecca and James.
Rebecca and James are incredible. We were so lucky to find them. I remember at the auditions, and we were auditioning them, and as soon as they did their like chemistry read together, we were just like, yeah, nailed it. They're absolutely incredible, amazing.
Can you talk a little bit about what Luke's like as a storyteller and what it was like to have him on set as your director?
Yeah, I mean, it's such a different thing to what he's usually been doing. So he originally, the way I met Luke was he directed me in a music video. So that was my first experience working with Luke, and I really enjoyed working with Luke and Josh as a team. They're very chilled, but very, very creative. They're happy to listen to other creatives on set, and I think that was the great thing about Braxton, is that every person in the crew could have their input and be like, I think this might work, and they would take that on board and would put, there's loads of little things in it where you watch it and you're like, oh, that was so-and-so's idea, and it worked. And then, so I think that was why it was so incredible, because it was such a lovely group effort for us all.
Is there one thing that you're most hoping people take overall from the experience of the film?
That's an interesting question. I think the whole theme of being able to overcome a bad situation, and that even if you find yourself in a situation, there's always a way out of it, there's always a hope, and there's always something that you can hold on to that will then pull you out and will make you be able to be a better person, I suppose.
Is there anything else on the horizon for you in 2021 and beyond?
So, in a completely unrelated note, I'm going to Lapland to work as an elf next week. So I'm going to go be an elf, but I've also got a movie on Amazon called Tales from the Lodge. Yeah, and things like that. I have my fingers in many different things.
Luke, it's amazing to have you here at Raindance. Congratulations on being an award winner. I guess the first most obvious question, for people who aren't familiar with the original book and have not yet seen the film, can you tell us just a little bit about what this story is all about and what it was that excited you as a storyteller when you first read that book when you were just 21?
Yeah, so the top line of the book and the film is that a young boy runs away from school where he's being bullied. He hides in an abandoned bathhouse and he falls in love with a water nymph. And so there's aspects of coming of age, there's aspects of fantasy, there's aspects of romance, but there's also some really hard-hitting sort of themes about class and about like financial difficulties, and also about just like bullying and alcoholism and things like that.
And obviously, at the centre, you've got a remarkable pairing with James and Rebecca. Can you talk about James first and what made him a right fit for our titular hero, Arthur Braxton?
So James is, I think, one of the most incredible actors I've ever met, to the point where I never know in real life when James is actually acting and when he's just being James. He's always in character, and that makes him such a natural actor. And he turned up at these auditions we had, and there was just something about him that just gave him such uniqueness and made you just care about him so much, just automatically, which is so important for a main character.
And obviously, playing someone ethereal who never gets out of the water is a challenging role. What was it about Rebecca that made her the right person to take on that challenge?
Yeah, so we were very lucky with Rebecca because she can swim really well. And I don't think anyone, even like us, the producers, Rebecca, or anybody, really took into account how much time she would be in the water, because she's in the water for the entire film. As for what makes Rebecca so perfect for the role, she gives such passion, and she's able to be simultaneously the kind of like naivety that we have from Delphina, because Delphina has never met anybody. Her character has lived in this pool, has only ever seen two people in her entire life, but then is able to give such passion and ferocity when it's needed around sort of two-thirds of the way through the film. Spoilers.
Obviously, alongside those young talents, you have the very familiar face of Mr. Johnny Vegas. Can you talk a little bit about what he brings to the production and whether or not it's maybe the kind of comedic persona that people, I guess, always associate him with?
So, Johnny, we were so lucky to have Johnny come in. We had him, we actually already started production when we found out Johnny was actually coming in. So we were really cutting it fine because we hadn't cast it. We were holding out for Johnny, and actually I wrote the character with Johnny in mind. What makes Johnny so unique is that, I mean, he himself has dealt with some of the problems that his character has dealt with, and he's overcome them. But in terms of him being a comedian, one of the things I've heard a lot in the industry is you can't get actors who are not funny to be funny, but you can get funny people to act really well. And Johnny, I mean, I really hope he goes on to just act and act and act and act and act. There's this adorable scene in one of his TV shows about glamping, where his mum says, "Oh, I don't like all this acting, all this comedy stuff you do. I want you to be a real actor." And I really hope that, you know, in other Braxton and in other acting roles he's done, he's found another love, right?
Talking about finding another love, obviously, many fans will be very familiar with you from your years and amazing amount of work on YouTube. I'm curious about the move to being a feature director and if that was something that was always a goal for you or something you've just naturally gravitated to over time.
Yeah, so I started YouTube when I was 15 years old and I got so into it that basically I kind of didn't really try very hard at school because I was so distracted making YouTube videos. And my excuse to my parents was always, at the age of 15, 16, I'm going to do YouTube, I'm going to get an audience, and I'm one day going to be able to make a film. And I have no idea if I actually fully believed that, but that is what happened. And so film was my original love. YouTube came along in 2009, and I had already been making films at home with my friends for years and years.
I mean, obviously, over the last couple of years, we've all been asking ourselves those big soul-searching questions, and I think a very common one has been why storytelling matters so much in our lives. I'm curious if you have an answer to that big question and what it means for you to be this kind of a storyteller.
Yeah, so I think we as humans, we try to make sense of the world through stories. The world is made up of so much information, our minds can't possibly actually process it, and so our brains sort of turn that into a story that isn't necessarily true, but it is helpful to make sense of the world. And so we're naturally storytellers. And then with storytelling, my goal is always to create something that just... you can't put your finger on it, but it feels true. And so finding that is the most satisfying thing you can do in filmmaking. And it's why I think films work so well, and books, and all the other types of stories. The most important thing to take away from this film, I think, is that people are not all one thing. I think a lot of the time we try and sort of typecast people as in certain ways and say people are just bad, are just good, are just hardworking, are just lazy, all that kind of thing. And in other Braxton, we really try and inject a bit of like gray area into those things. The other thing, this is a bit of I don't want to spoil the end actually, because there is a real takeaway at the end and I can sum it up in about 5 words, but I will ruin the end of the film and I cannot do that.
You're here at Raindance. What does it mean for you not only to be part of the festival, but to have the film already have been successful in this year's award ceremony, honored in the way it has been?
I mean, to be at Raindance at all already meant so much, but to have won UK Best Feature at Raindance for this film that we have poured our heart and soul into for 4 or 5 years, 6 years in the case of me and my producer, it just means so much. And especially to have my first feature, I've come from a different world. I'm not originally a filmmaker, I'm a YouTuber, and that comes with it a lot of baggage. And so to have an award for the film we have made to validate the fact that we're actually all right at what we do is not only really like an honor, it's also really valuable and really important to us, because, and important to me, because it means I can believe in myself, right? Not that external validation is all that matters, but it means so much. I honestly haven't come up against really any resistance to the fact that I'm a YouTuber trying to make it in other worlds. Especially, I did when I started. When I started, the idea that I was even going to be a YouTuber was a ridiculous suggestion, because being a YouTuber wasn't a thing yet. But in terms of like trying to make it in other worlds, I think being a YouTuber and sort of social media world in general has sort of reached a point where it's entered into the mainstream. And I've only ever heard people say, "Ooh, being a YouTuber might be a problem for you." I've never actually found it to be a problem. I don't know where I'll be with YouTube, to be honest. I never want to give it up. I don't want to do like a hard cut, that's it, I'm done, because I value having an outlet that is mine that I completely control. Ultimately, when you're making a film, there's so many layers of people in between what I want to make. There's money problems, there are producers, there's distributors, there's all these other interests, and all valid interests. But I value having a direct outlet that I can have with an audience, whether that's YouTube, whether it's Instagram, whether it's TikTok, whether it's whatever. I really value that, and I'm not going to throw it away.
As I
does it feel to be here tonight, Johnny, at Raindance Film Festival?
I love this stuff. I think my entire career has been about... I don't like the phrase punching above your weight, and great ideas that make it through to fruition and to getting made and to being recognised. And for indie filmmakers, I feel like I'm just a tiny part in this, but a really bizarre multiple, like 6 degrees of separation of, I directed an actress whose dad financed the film. So it was like, what's lovely is it was people scratching other people's backs going, yeah, of course I'll come in and it'll be a stretch, but I'll play a dad who's a heavy drinker. And I'm just thrilled for everyone on the production side. To me, I think it was in for 5 days. But playing his dad and playing across, or, you know, that far away, for such a brilliant young actor, it was, for me, it's a blessing to be part of it like this. I'm here to celebrate everybody else's success and apologise for my poor acting.
Working with Luke behind the camera, I mean, you talk about great young performers and young talents, he's a great young director.
I was kind of, it knocked me sideways, because I've gradually directed and I've done things, and to work with such a young director who came from a kind of vlogging and blogging background where you got a slide of grace or it'll be disastrous, because it's, you know, you get all full of yourself going, it's a film, it's a proper film, people are going to see. And there was a level of professionalism to it that I found, like, I was like, you've got to up your game, and it's good, and you've always got to do that. If you work in film or TV, if you're resentful of new talent coming through, you've lost inspiration. So when you see how somebody else works, and then you go, right, next thing you direct, I want to be better than him, but in the nicest possible, you know, it's a compliment. Not confrontational. Not things were better in my day. I realise I'm at that age now, and you go, I'm always chuffed when new talent comes through. I think if you ever went to art school, you're encouraged to create. You're encouraged to push boundaries. You're encouraged to make something for you and hope that everybody else will accept and encompass it. So it was a really good kick up the arse. A really good kick up the arse. And I love kicks up the arse, because it's very easy to get it's a beautiful word, comfortable. You get comfortable in your career. And then when you work with new talent, you go, right, get out of that zone, you know what I mean? Because you're a gun, not a gun for hire, but you've just become an actor, and that's no offence to actors, but you go, I was always thinking what's going on behind the camera, in front of the camera, what the art department are doing, the set design, you're looking at stuff. So it's nice, but I'm overall, it's like, it sounds so egotistical. It's not about me, it's about them. And if they've won this award, they've made a great film. So what a pleasure to be part of it.
Yeah, that's lovely.